A rising tide lifts all ships. Okay? And I'm very pleased to have been able to make a breakthrough and share that with the world about the whole continuity issue and what this world is really about. And this is something ultimately that lifts everybody up, even though they may not be aware of it. It's a major clarification, modern breakthrough in these times here, to have a perspective on the totality of the situation, put it into modern terms right here, right now. So we can use parables about the prodigal son to talk about this if we want to. The prodigal son is in the father's house, a mansion, and the prodigal son says, you know, I want to leave and go to my own house. Now, the father's mansion knows there is no other house. In other words, reality, zero dimensionality, pure isn'tness, pure spaciousness, uncrystallized, pure spaciousness, the everywhereness of God. There is no other place outside of the everywhereness. That is God's house. It's everywhereness. There is no other place to dwell. So the prodigal son says, I'm going to go and live in my own house, kind of like a young adult or a teenager saying, I want to run away from home just for the sheer adventure of it, really. It was a whim of the prodigal son. And God says, oh, well, okay. So prodigal son, what happens? Does it wander off somewhere? No, actually what happens, the prodigal son falls into a deep sleep and starts dreaming, starts imagining. And this imagination takes the form of an adventure, a journey to its new home, a journey to its home, its home, where it is ruling the roost. It takes the form of a journey, a long, epic journey, an odyssey. Not only that, but the journey turns out to be a journey of forgetfulness of the prodigal son's true home, the home with God. It's a journey of forgetfulness. So on the journey is dreamed so that it paints a picture of an adventure which is totally different than reality. Totally different. A dream of impermanence, a dream of vulnerability, a dream of fear, a dream of death. Okay, a dream of decay, disintegration, all of this dream is the opposite of reality, has nothing to do with reality. It's actually a journey of forgetfulness. And this is by design, because the prodigal son has an advisor on this journey, kind of like a wise advisor. It's called the ego. And the ego says, hey, son, you know, on your journey to your new home, the reason why you're not arriving, not finding it, you haven't arrived at it, is because you haven't forgotten reality yet. Not reality, your previous home. You haven't forgotten your previous home, which actually is reality. You haven't forgotten your previous home. That's why you haven't found your new one. But as soon as you totally forget your previous home, that's when you will find your new home. And so the prodigal son says, oh, great. And so the prodigal son is working so hard at forgetting its previous home, reality. And so all these adventures that it has are adventures in forgetfulness, actually. Adventures in forgetfulness. And it's all a dream. The prodigal son hasn't actually gone anywhere, because how can you go anywhere in everywhereness? You can't leave it at all, right? It's just lay down and started sleeping and dreaming. So the ego says, look, prodigal son, you haven't found your new house because you have a continuity problem, because you don't want to let go of your previous home. And you've got to learn how to let go of it. And you're not ready to find your new home because you're not used to the conditions of your new home. So we got to get you ready. Let's get ready for your new home. And so we go through all these adventures. We call them lessons, learning lessons. We go through these evolution, learning lessons. We are learning how to get into our comfort zone, into a comfort zone, a new comfort zone. So then we'll be able to segue into our new house and we'll say, ah, this feels comfortable, I like this house. And we have to totally forget about our previous house, the ego tells us. Otherwise, we won't feel comfortable in our new house. Of course not. This is the fundamental story, the fundamental situation that we are up against. And we think that we're getting there. We're getting there. You know, almost got it. We're getting there. We're making progress. We've really, 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 really forgotten our true home, but not entirely. And the ego keeps saying, you haven't found your new home because you haven't entirely forgotten it. And you say, yeah, I think there might be some vague, you know, fuzzy vestige of something inside of me. I just, you know, I haven't quite purged it entirely yet. Well, of course, this is all a trick, a deception, because there is no new home for the Son of God. There is no new home. It's a journey to nowhere. It's an aimless wandering around. All these training exercises of continuity that the ego is having us undergo are useless. They don't benefit us in the slightest bit. In fact, what they do is they actually bring about a real continuity problem with going back to waking up. Waking up and realizing you never left your home. It produces a very severe continuity problem in that direction, you see. And that is what we call the real continuity problem. Because we have been working so hard to forget reality, so we think that's the necessary qualification in order to find our new home. We've been working at it for so long and so intensely that we've really, really has the most fuzziest idea of our true home. So vague and fuzzy and seemingly distant and forgotten, you know. So we're like terrified to wake up. And that's the real continuity problem. And we have an advisor to resolve that continuity problem called the Holy Spirit. You can call whatever you want, the grace of God, the voice of reason, whatever. We have an advisor that says that there is a way to solve this continuity problem. And that is we need to be reminded of reality without waking up, before we wake up. We be reminded of reality and we don't attack our journey. All these training exercises, we don't try to attack those and change them. What we do is we see everything on the journey. We see everything is incredibly beautiful and peaceful and tranquil without any exception. Equal beauty everywhere. So the whole journey now becomes incredibly beautiful for us. And no matter what happens in the world, everything is exquisitely beautiful. And we say, wow, you know, this really reminds me of something. I'm really reminded very strongly. It's like a scent of something. You say, oh, that scent, I've smelled that scent before. I'm just trying to think, well, where did I smell that scent before? And it really brings about this tremendous sense of remembrance. Like, oh, you know, this feels like someplace that I really wanted, I used to dwell in, I used to be there, where did I used to be? And it gradually, you know, gradually gets the cobwebs out until you're ready to actually wake up from the dream. This is the way the Holy Spirit solves the genuine continuity problem we have. The ego's continuity problem is a lie, a total lie. The ego just told us that hey, yeah, you do have a new house. It's just that you're still too used to the old house. That's why you can't find the new one, and so you have a continuity problem there. That's a lie. There is no new house to find. Some separate house, like separate from God's house. It's no such place. So, but in pursuing that, a real, genuine continuity problem arises for us. Like, how in the heck do I wake up from this crazy dream? And this is essentially the whole story. And so when we accept the vision of the blessed world where everything looks blessed, equally blessed, including every person, okay, in the world. Now, you can tell if you're getting close to this vision by starting to point out various people and say, this person is my deeply blessed friend, greatly blessed friend. I see this one as a greatly blessed. You can say, I see this one as greatly blessed. And you can say, my friend, if you want to. I see this one as, you know, very blessed. My dear blessed friend. This is my dear blessed friend. And you start saying this to different people. And then you start saying it to political figures, to religious figures, to various, all these, you know, figures. And if you can genuinely feel and say, yeah, this is my dearly blessed friend, to everybody on the planet, everybody that's ever lived, everybody that ever will live, everybody that's living now, and say, yeah, I'm happy to see everybody is blessed. Everybody's my blessed friend. Without any exception, not even one exception, then you have to be getting very close. So I did that exercise today, and I was able to do it. I couldn't come up with a single person that I wouldn't say, this is my dearly blessed friend. Because I know from a purely pragmatic standpoint, that is necessary in order to wake up from this horrible self-delusional dream adventure that we've been on, trying to find a new house. Remember, the true religion is pure pragmatism. Pure pragmatism is the true religion because it's what works. It's all about what works. The Holy Spirit is purely pragmatic. It knows what works for us. There's no point in being a noble failure. Absolutely no point in being a noble failure. I know so many people try that for a while. Like, I don't care what works they say. I'm going to do what I think is very noble. And it fails. And then they say, well, I'm a noble failure. Nah. What good is that? What good is that? Have to be a success. And a success means you need to be reminded of reality. And remember, reality, everything is blessed, equally blessed in reality. No other way it could possibly be. Everything's equally abiding in reality, in pure spaciousness. So how can we be reminded of that unless we have a non-exclusive vision, a same, without excluding anything? How is it possible? If we exclude just one person, that will not remind us of reality at all. It will not. They'll say, wow, that doesn't remind me. That doesn't remind us at all. The whole point of being reminded is that we see everything as equally blessed. There's no more here, less there. This person's excluded. I listen to some people who claim to be, you know, very spiritual people, and then they'll go off and like start ripping George Bush, for instance. Say, oh, this guy's the most terrible demon, you know. I say, whoa. That's not reminding anybody of reality. Now, you should easily be able to say, my dearly blessed friend George Bush, and then my dearly blessed friend Barack Obama. See, my dearly blessed friend Al Gore. My dearly blessed friend who Rush Limbaugh. My dearly blessed friend Pope Francis. My dearly blessed friend Bill Maher or something. And you know, whoever comes to mind, oh, my dearly blessed friend Oprah Winfrey, you know, and be actually from your heart saying, actually, no, that's absolutely, because they're going to be blessed by vision too. In your vision, they're totally blessed. In the vision of the Holy Spirit, they're totally blessed. Everything is totally blessed. No exceptions. Okay. That trumps all these petty, spats that are going on. Because remember, your religion, true religion, is pure pragmatism. We're going for what actually works. Everything else out the door means nothing because it fails. It fails, so it doesn't mean anything to us. So all this fighting, and I hate this person, I love this person. And by the way, a big mistake that many people make here is they say, you know what, I really hate all these people here, but I'm going to make up for that by loving, you know, a few people very much. And then some people say, well, I love this teacher or something. I just love them so much. And they think, okay, then now, so I've shown God how much I love this great teacher. And then I'm going to hate all these other people. Say, oh, but I really hate them, and I really hate them, and I hate them, and I want to attack them and stuff. That doesn't work. That absolutely doesn't work. You have to love everyone equally. You have to be willing to see the vision of the Holy Spirit where everyone is equally blessed. You can see it. You literally see, wow, they're really blessed. That person's totally blessed too, and that one is too. And you realize everybody is totally blessed without exception. So there's no politics in it. You know, there's no issues. You know, you can, doesn't matter what spectrum a person is and all their viewpoints, etc. They are my totally blessed dear friend. No question about it. No question about it. Because keep in mind, they are simply dreaming too about trying to find a new home, and they're all confused about this continuity issue. But eventually they'll sort it out. The Holy Spirit will help them, and then they'll also have a vision of everything being blessed. And then you'll say, wow, what an incredibly wonderful person they are. What a blessed person they are. So, you know, the fact is that all of us are totally blessed in reality, and we're sleeping and dreaming. but we'll wake up from that dream eventually. So see them as your dear, you know, brother, sister, blessed spirit, you know. See them as that, because that's what they really are. That's what they really are. That trumps any silly nonsense they're engaged in trying to learn, forget reality so they can find their new home. It's aimless wandering, you know, aimless wandering. You don't need to have compassion on people. Just see them as your dearly blessed friend. That's all. Just see them that way. You don't have to pal around with them. But in your heart, you'd be willing to see them that way. So you do get the types who are talk great spiritual talk, and yet they'll slam some, you know, political figure, social, they'll slam something, you know. Yeah, I've done that too, of course, because I'm not awakened yet. I haven't seen the vision of blessedness, but I try to tone it down as much as possible, and any mistakes are to be corrected. And I'm seeing it today. Now you can't do that. I mean, we can do it in just our everyday blah 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 talk, but as far as salvation goes, we really have to practice just checking in to see if we can feel that way, if that's okay with us. And I said, yeah, it's absolutely okay. Well, wouldn't bother me in the slightest bit as seeing everybody blessed, including everybody in history. Even the people who've done very wicked things, terrible things, they too are my dearly, dearly blessed friend. They too are my dearly blessed friend, absolutely. It's just the same as the ones who've done all the good stuff, the ones who've done all the bad stuff, they're still my dearly blessed friend, absolutely. Because the Holy Spirit blesses them equally, blesses everything equally. Pure pragmatism, that's what reminds us of reality, and we have to wake up from this dream. And that's the only way. You cannot wake up from it by making exceptions and say, yeah, I love everybody except that terrible person over there. That will not work at all. Will not work at all. Total failure. And of course, the ego diverts our spiritual intent by trying to get us to build up the self-righteousness of spirituality, all the while channeling our, you know, hostility and aggression towards a few people or a small segment of people or whatever, you know, different things. And they think, well, that's justified. That's okay. Yeah, you can hate them. That's okay. That won't bother you. That won't stop you. But what that does is it furthers your forgetfulness of reality, is what it really does. And so you think you're making progress because you think the ego's God. Because the ego is telling you, oh yeah, I have this wonderful new home for you, and I'm helping you get there, and all this stuff is necessary, and I've produced all this training exercise so you can get there. And so you think, wow, the God was doing such a great job in my life, etc., like that. And so you don't even question it. You don't realize that you're being tricked. Unfortunately, we have genuine teachers who have told us the truth about this. So when you really can feel that this is also my truly blessed friend, that you actually in your heart see it that way, and I really do, even though I may disagree with the policies of all, you know, all these people, etc., that's superficial. Bottom line is absolutely everyone is my dearly blessed friend, absolutely everyone without exception. That's where we have to keep on keeping on that way, and the more we clarify the whole situation, the easier that becomes, because you realize they are your dearly blessed friend. They're just having this crazy dream adventure, thinking they're going to a new home and putting themselves through the most horrible torture and self-aggrandizement and all these, you know, things that are just like almost embarrassing, you know. But it doesn't matter, they're still our dearly blessed friend. And that trumps all the shame and the embarrassment and the aggressiveness and everything, that trumps everything. And again, it doesn't mean you have to support their policies or pal around with them or anything like that. It's much, much deeper than that. So, there is a way to get back home. There is a way to wake up and realize you never left home. That's the way to get back home. Never left. We never made any progress finding our new home because there isn't one. So we've been aimlessly wandering around. But the Holy Spirit has this perception for us of this equal blessedness, equal sacredness, equal sameness, equal smoothness, non-crystallized smoothness, non-crystallized sacredness, non-crystallized holiness, non-crystallized blessedness, as if it were spaciousness surrounding and permeating everything, that you just say, wow, that's my dear sacred friend, the plant over there, that's my dear sacred friend, the plant. Oh, that dust particle, that's my dear sacred friend, the dust particle. Oh, this rock, oh, that's my dear sacred friend, the rock. Wow, so cool, so wonderful to see you. You know, everything is like that. Everything is your dear sacred friend. You're so happy to see it. So happy to see it, so happy to see you, you know. Not just some people, not some holy person you go see or some friend. Every last thing, oh, you see a bird fly by, oh, see, wonderful, there's my wonderful sacred friend, that bird. What great friends we are. What a blessed friend that is. What a blessed leaf. What a blessed star. That's my friend, dear friend. So it's not just like superficially beautiful. You feel this kinship, like this is my really dear blessed friend. And this space is my dear blessed friend of this space here. And that water, that lake, that's my dear blessed friend, that this lake is, wow, seems so much akin to me, so much a friend to me. So everything, not just people, everything, you feel this tremendous sacred kinship and friendship, a really blessed friend everywhere, everything. That's the actual pragmatic way, the only way that actually helps us wake up. It enables us to eventually wake up from this dream adventure. That's how it's done. You have to have this. You must have this vision of oneness, as to use shorthand oneness. I've described it in greater detail here. And again, it's not just people. It is everything. Exhaust coming out of a tailpipe. Oh, that's my dear blessed friend, that exhaust is such a wonderful blessed friend. You know, everything is that way. A blade of grass, an electric cord. There's nothing that isn't that way. Nothing that isn't that way. So in a nutshell, this is what it's all about. And to be able to speak about this, openly share it, not for argumentation or dispute, but just like a rising tide, is a blessing. It's a real blessing. I'm happy to be able to do this. And it's significant, actually, because it's not easy to be able to explain this clearly. It really isn't, which is why it doesn't get explained very clearly very often. And this really does lift all boats a little bit. You know, it does. And we have this vision to look forward to. We really do. Now, does it help to go to places where you feel this kinship? Yeah, maybe it does. Maybe that gets some sort of catalyst, you know. I don't know the answer to that exactly. If you go to a place and you feel, well, one of the problems that people do is they feel like wherever they are, it's like, wow, I don't really have this great kinship here. I kind of feel like I'm in the boondocks, you know. It's not really friendly. Everything feels kind of hostile and rough, and it's really not really sophisticated culture of living. I feel like I live in the boondocks. And so they say, you know what, I take a vacation, I go somewhere. You see people when they're going on vacation, they're smiling and they're very like hopeful. Like they say, I'm going to somewhere that really I'll feel this sense of warmth and friendliness about everything will feel friendly to me. The aloha spirit will be there. And when they get there, they kind of gradually realize it's the same. It's the same. And then if they have the means, they'll travel somewhere else. So I know people who are constantly traveling, actually. And people think that they're very spiritual because they seem very optimistic, right? And like, they say, wow, You know why they're so optimistic? Because they know that they're going to soon be leaving wherever they are, going to somewhere else. And they're addicted to this. They think that when they get somewhere else, that's when they will find it. Their true comfort zone, where they feel everything is their dear, blessed friend. And they think that way because they're leaving what isn't. They say, oh, this isn't it here, but I'm leaving it. And so they have this kind of spiritual manner about them that people think, oh, they're very spiritual. You know, this happens to some people who say that who go about talking to groups and keep moving and traveling all over the place, and they're able to give the spiritual rhetoric, you know, and talk the talk about all this stuff. And people think they're very, very, you know, oh, the saint, you know, they're enlightened and everything. And of course, they're saying like, well, I feel very happy and I'm very, you know, wonderful. Why? Because they know they're going to be leaving the next day and they're going somewhere else. And they think that that next place they're going to is going to be really great. So the people get this buzz from them because they're going somewhere else. And they think, oh, they're really spiritually high. Look at this, you know, they're feeling like so warmth and friendliness is they're just about ready to enter into it. Are they enlightened? Are they really enlightened? Are they really seeing it? Now, those who actually do see the vision of the blessed world are actually quite different. You can notice the difference. When you know a real genuine one who has done this, then you can tell the difference. You really can. You really can. And they, you can just tell that whatever they're looking at right now, they are seeing their dear friend. The bliss is right here, right now. And it's not a matter of them needing to go anywhere whatsoever. Now, they will go somewhere at some point because it's not a matter of staying either for them, you see. But it's continuous. It's a continuous, seamless, right here, right now, and it's unmistakable. It is unmistakable. Compared to those who, you know, holding these retreats in Hawaii or Costa Rica, they're going on cruises to the Greek islands, they're doing all this stuff. And of course, they're always looking for the next wonderful retreat in paradise and stuff. And so they're talking to folks and they're thinking like, wow, when I get to Hawaii, it's gonna be so just incredible. Wow, everything, the Aloha spirit's just gonna be permeating everywhere. It's gonna be great. Plumeria blossoms, you know, it's just wow. And they're thinking of that. And so they get to Hawaii and they realize, wow, it's the same unfriendliness. I don't really feel it here, but I'm going to the Greek islands next. And that cruise is going to be unbelievable. It's going to be so spiritual there. And they get on the cruise and then they're starting to think, wow, you know, it's just the same old stuff here. I don't quite get it here. But, you know, they're going to these workshops in Costa Rica, and then they're back here to Sedona, and then they're, you know, moving around like that all the time. And people think, wow, they really have a buzz going. Wow, it's kind of a spiritual buzz they've got. No, they're just having a fun game, you know, they're having some fun. But it's got nothing to do with enlightenment. It's not pure pragmatism. It doesn't work. It doesn't work. That doesn't work. It doesn't work. And you see, a real teacher just floors you because you say, holy cow, they're seeing it right here, right now. They're seeing that dust particle. And that dust particle is the most beautiful friend in the universe to them. Dear, dear friend. And they're seeing a little bird there that's chirping, and that bird is their dearest friend, absolute blessed dear friend. And they're seeing the rays of sunlight come in, that's the dear blessed rays of sunlight. And they see you sitting there, and you're their dear blessed friend. You know, and they see the cat wandering there, that the cat is their dear blessed friend. In every single situation, thing, everything is their dear blessed friend, and it doesn't stop. It doesn't stop when they get up to leave. You know, even when they're leaving, everything is their dear blessed friend, and they go as they're moving forward. Everything is still their dear blessed friend, without any exceptions, no exclusivity. They're not like seeking for it. They're just immersed in it. Those are the real teachers. Those are the ones who are actually enlightened. That's actual enlightenment. You've got a lot of people claiming enlightenment who aren't actually enlightened, that is for sure. But they think they're almost enlightened, you know, almost enlightened. I'm the first one to say I'm definitely not enlightened, and I can't even say I'm almost enlightened, but maybe I am, maybe I'm not, I don't know. I'm certainly trying, you know, working towards it. Now, if you're not enlightened, you can go to some nice place and maybe you will feel something there like, the atmosphere is so nice. You know, the ocean is so nice. I feel this kinship with the ocean. I feel this, you know, and you could maybe start to spread this feeling of like, I feel this tremendous kinship everywhere. And you know, maybe that can be helpful for people. Yeah, absolutely. It's possible. I don't know. If some say that it helps, then fine. Some say just sitting in a cave is the way to do it. You know, that can work for some people too. You just don't want to fool yourself. You have to be very clear about what enlightenment really is, how the continuity problem is really resolved, and realize that you're not there yet, you're not there yet, you're not there yet. Don't say you're enlightened. That's a big mistake. It's a big mistake. You're creating delay for yourself and for other people, actually. Even if you think you're almost enlightened. No, there is no almost enlightened. You either are or you're not. You're either making an exception or you're not. If you're even making one exception, you're not enlightened. You are not enlightened. That's not the vision. I don't care if you have a, say, everything is your dear blessed friend, except this one thing isn't. You are not enlightened. You are not. And you can't say you're close either, because you may actually think that that's it, where it absolutely is not at all. You say, well, close is good enough. No, it's not. Close is not good enough. It doesn't work. Close doesn't work. So it's not pragmatic at all. It doesn't work. And you say, well, it's a very noble failure. I love so many people, but, you know, I failed, but it's a noble failure. That's good enough. No, it's not. Noble failures are not good enough. So we have to continually work on clarification, realization of accepting this condition of everything is equally blessed. Keep working on that. Not anyone specially, no special people, no special things, no special persons, no exceptional persons, no exceptions at all. This speck of dust is just as dear to you as your best friend or something, or someone you know well, or a stray dog. It doesn't matter. Everything equally dear to you, equally blessed, is my dear blessed friend, equally so, effortlessly, equally and effortlessly so. That is literally the vision of oneness, the vision of Christ, the vision of blessedness, the vision of sacredness. That is what works. So it's pure pragmatism. That's what actually works. And we have those who have done that to tell us that's what works. And there's no way around it. There is no way around it. Not making one exception, that's a way to try to get around it. That's not it. That's not it. That absolutely will cost you to continue. The ego still has you, and you will continue your ventures towards your non-existent new home. As long as you're making that exception, the ego still has you, absolutely has you. So you can try, just name these people, like you think you politically you hate, or you know, whatever it may be, on the right, on the left, people have all these passions, and different lifestyles, people have passions about that, and you know, the thing is, everybody in this world wants you to take sides, and in spiritual path, you cannot take sides like that. Superficially you can, that's fine, doesn't matter, superficially, but as far as how you really feel, no, you cannot take sides like that. I may disagree like with what the Pope is doing, for instance, but as far as how I feel about the actual person, you know, I say he's my dearly, dearly blessed friend, absolutely, just the same as some street beggar in the streets of Calcutta is my dearly blessed friend. No difference. I don't see any difference. As far as the kinship and friendship, no difference there. The blessedness, no difference there. Now, obviously, there are superficial, worldly differences, but we're talking about spiritual differences. There are no spiritual differences there. So from a pragmatic standpoint, you have to work on this. And it's not easy, but the more clarification you do about what the problem really is, the easier it gets. Easier it gets. I just tried it today and it was easy. It was easy. The world paints all these villains everywhere, terrible villains. They're supposed to hate them. And there's so much hatred in the world. Look on the internet, just so much hatred. And, you know, when somebody does something very bad, atrocious in the world, I always feel very badly about the people who hate them, because I know that's hurting their own spiritual, from a practical standpoint, it's very delaying for them, very much delaying. And so I try to support the person who's done something bad, but for the sake of saying, look, people, don't delay your spiritual path just, you know, to hate this person. That's very bad. Don't do it. You condemn the action, say, wow, you know, on that level, I don't like that action at all. But this is still my dearly blessed friend, without any question whatsoever. And I don't feel any less that way just because what they did than some exemplary person. No change in that at all. You cannot change that attitude at all. You must love everyone equally. Have to. But it's not a superficial love. See, that's the problem that people have gotten into. They think it's an affectionate, superficial love. No. That's not it. It is willing to see them as truly blessed, or dear, dear, dear friend. True kinship. Totally blessed friend. It's that level. It's that level. When you try to do it superficially, it's impossible. You know, you try to do the level of emotions and reactions and stuff, you're just trying to force it, you know, and you try to appear to be a very righteous person, but inside you're just seething with hatreds and you're all conflicted and upset about it. Now, don't try to solve it at that level at all. Think about if you're in the most sacred place, holy place, or such a wonderful place, and there's someone that you've hated before comes there and sits down and says, I just want to sit here with you. How would you feel then? You know, you'd probably feel, you know, welcome. I'm so glad you came. You know, what a great blessed friend, you know. And let's just sit here in true kinship, spiritual kinship. That's probably how you'd feel. So look at it that way, that you have this spiritual kinship with everybody. And as you're driving along the road, as you're going places, just say, yeah, that person is my dear blessed friend. Everybody you see, everything you see, just state that to yourself. That tree, that's my dear blessed friend. That tree is such a, you know, such a great friend. What a blessed friend that is. I've known that tree forever. I've known this person forever. I've been a friend. This has been a friend to me forever. This tree has always been my friend. This grass has always been my friend. This sidewalk has always been my friend. This road has always been my dearly blessed friend. This building has always been my dearly blessed friend. This sky has always been my dearly best friend. This whatever, you know. This person. But you don't go up and hug them, right? It's not at that level. It's not at that level at all. Yeah, they may do something to irritate you, and you might say, you know, you might react or something. That's fine. It doesn't change the fact that they're your dearly blessed friend forever, have always been so. And it's not about loving them forever and loving. No, they are your dearly blessed friend, true kinship, always have been, always will be. It's deeper than emotion. It's deeper than affection. I see these people going hugging everybody. You know, they're trying to show everybody how spiritual they are. It's not like that. Because actually, it's not about just people. It's about the totality. You don't see the ones who are truly enlightened going around hugging everybody. Not really. I suppose it's possible, but generally it doesn't work out that way, really. Because the kinship would be completely beyond the body. Completely beyond the body. It is, and it's not about you and me or something. It's about everything equally. It's about everything equally. So when you start hugging people, you create this emotional attachment, you see, with a person. They think, oh, I'm so special. They think I'm special. You're special. You know, can be a big problem. It's better to sit silently. Not everything, everything, everything that's going on is my awesome, wonderful, forever friend. Blessed friend, you know. Really, everything's totally blessed. And just abide in that feeling of total blessedness for everything. So like when maybe someone's enlightened, you come into the room, they're there, they may not even pay any attention to you. And you just sit down. And because they're experiencing everything as equally blessed. And so that's the whole point of it. Not that, oh, you are my dear friend, you know, to the exclusion of everything else that's going on. They want you to recognize the totality of it. It's not just about people or persons at all. It's about everything. All decorations and spaciousness. This moment is my dearly blessed friend, this very moment. And this moment too. And this moment too. And this moment too. This totality of this moment. Totality of this moment. Now it's possible to play games with this, and many people have done so. Because they're still feeling very adventurous and thinking that maybe they can find their new home by playing games with this. But it's serious business. You don't want to encourage that. So it's not about anybody, it's about everybody. It's not about everybody, even it's about everything. It's about all decorations that arise in the whole universe. It's about that. Everything. We have this total kinship. An eternal kinship. That we feel is this very, very blessed friend. Now some people are more people persons, so they tend to gravitate to people. Other people are more nature persons. They tend to gravitate towards nature. And some, there's sort of a balance there. So some people just want to sit somewhere and look at the whole nature of the world and just sit there and see how it's all their blessed friend. And other people will feel they want to relate to other bodies, you know, and then say that they're their dear blessed friend, that kind of thing. But ultimately, it's the totality of it. We can't make exceptions. Because some people may express it a little differently than others, have their own styles. That's possible too. That is pretty much not that important. What's important is to look at just this very simply, very simply. You can't make exceptions. In your heart, you can't make exceptions. You don't have to act all affectionate to everybody. No, you don't have to do that. You can think of all the people in prison, the terrible people there, and just say, well, yeah, that person's my dearly blessed friend too. Absolutely, just the same as the best person in the world. No difference. That doesn't mean that you want to hang out with them or you think, oh, what they did was a wonderful thing or anything like that. No, that's not the point. Again, you will know you're making genuine progress when your hate, this inner hatred is dissolved for everybody. You can't find it in your heart to really hate anybody. At a deep level. I read the newspaper, I get irritated, say, oh my God, I'm so tired of this, just, I hate this, so tired of this stuff, and these stories and stuff. But do I really hate the people? No, absolutely not. Not today, like I went somewhere, and I turned out that it was a dead end. I wasn't supposed to be there. And when I was there, I asked somebody a question, and they were kind of gruff and didn't recognize me. I said, wow, you know, they should have recognized me and been nicer to me and stuff. But that actually caused me then to leave the place, which then caused me to actually get on track of what I was supposed to do, which then has turned out fantastic. And I took it that way. I said, you know what? That was just a helpful hand there, helpful hand. So if someone's gruff to you or not nice, you don't hate them. Just take everything as grace, that everything is really there to help you. That's one spiritual technique that some people use, that everything is grace, everything is grace. No matter what happens, it's all grace. That is a technique. The other is to just serve everybody, serve, be in service to everyone. That's another technique. These are various ways to accomplish the same end, which is to get to this vision of blessedness without any exceptions. Definitely we have to get there. However we get there, we have to get there. But try not to play games with it. That's where you get into to trouble. That's why I say the mood of repentance is super important. Keep yourself in this humble mood of saying, I've got a problem. I've got a severe problem. I'm making an exception. I'm not having the continuity problem resolved because I'm not seeing the vision of blessedness. So my continuity problem is not getting resolved, which means the ego is able to use leverage against me, keep me in this death training program, the training of forgetfulness. That is a severe problem. So say, I have a severe problem. So let's stop, you know, kidding around here. You know, don't go out and pretend to be enlightened or whatever, traipsing around the world and stuff and impressing people with how you're able to regurgitate, you know, some profound teaching or something. Say, I've got a severe problem. And you stay very sober in that way. Mood of repentance is super important. Say, I'm making an exception. Somehow I'm making some exception and I just refuse, you know, to let go of it. Why am I making that exception? You know, you have to keep working at it, keep working at it, keep working at it. Don't set up shop on the side of the path. Otherwise you'll be a shopkeeper by the side of the path. You know, and people will come by and you'll chit-chat spiritual stuff and you'll do some bargaining with them, business with them, and they'll move on and you're still stuck in this roadside bazaar, you know. Not finishing. So again, this sharing here, I'm not enlightened. I've not seen the vision of blessedness. Absolutely not. But I am clued into it for sure. And I can see why we need it very clearly. And I can see the overall big picture of how we're deceiving ourselves with this. Belief that we need to forget reality in order to find our new home. It's total self-deception. And that we do have this continuity problem is all very, very clear. But still, I must be making exceptions. I'm not able to accept the equal vision of blessed world yet. Not yet. But that's the position that virtually everybody's in. So it is helpful to at least clarify this, clarification. And once you actually see the vision of blessedness, then you're at a much higher degree of helpfulness. It's like a really high tide, very high tide, that really lifts all boats up quite a bit. Because people are then struck by that, and they realize that it's true, it's there, it's really there, it really is there, it really, this is the way, and you feel it, you know it. So even in celebrating successes, still remain humble in the mood of repentance. It was a great success to see this egoic deception of how it tells us that we have a continuity problem with our new home, and we need to solve this continuity problem by working on death and impermanence and forgetting about, that helps us forget about reality, and then that will then solve the continuity problem, and poof, magically we'll be in our new home and we'll be all perfectly happy and saved and in paradise, etc. Seeing that, and then how the Holy Spirit then solves this real continuity problem we have with actually awakening from all this false continuity problem. That is a huge success, actually. Gigantic success. But, you know, I'm still staying, you know, sober and in the mood of repentance and still working on it. Say, okay, that's great, milestone, but, you know, keep your nose to the grindstone, keep working here. And that's what you got to do. You got to do that. You got to keep working no matter what until finally you literally do see the vision of blessedness. And then it's a new ballgame as far as how you relate and effectiveness, etc. It'll be a new ballgame at that point. You really will impress people at a deep level, a real deep level, beyond words. It'll be beyond words, definitely. The impression will be tremendous impression beyond all words. No matter what they say, it doesn't matter. The impression is beyond words. But words have a place in clarification. They help. They can be very helpful to keep looking, keep looking, keep looking. And encouragement, encouragement, encouragement. All right. Hopefully this has been encouraging. And keep on, you know, imparting this clarity. Keep it simple. Keep it simple. Keep it easy. Keep it simple. Keep it easy. Keep it very, very simple, very easy. Continuity problem is the only problem we have. It's the only issue we need to focus on, is the continuity issue. And eventually, the situation will become very simple and easy to see. And then you realize, hey, I'm making real progress here. Okay, and then see, go towards seeing everything as your dear friend. Realize that's the goal without even one exception. Okay? And just stick with it, stick with it, stick with it. Keep working intensely at it, because the world is continuing on its crazy adventure of forgetfulness of reality to an extreme extent, to a severe extent, and to coming up soon to just almost an unimaginable extent of exercises in forgetting reality, trying to forget reality, which means a great deal of turmoil and of all types, which, of course, a heavy, heavy dose of forgetfulness, very heavy. All profiting us nothing whatsoever, nothing whatsoever. There is no new home for us. Never has been, never will be. Okay, so that going through that won't help us. So we might as well get this tranquility. We might as well get this vision of blessedness. We might as well choose that. We might as well choose that, because otherwise we'll just be wandering aimlessly in trauma, in turmoil. You know that, and all for nothing, all for nothing. So stick with it intensely. All right, that greater great, that's it.